Recall that chronic myeloid leukemia has three phases. First mutation that triggers chronic myeloid leukemia causes reciprocal translocation between chromosomes 9 and 22 and results in significant increase in proliferation of granulocytes. Recall that on chromosome 9 located ABL1 gene that encodes a specific enzyme called tyrosine kinase. The function of tyrosine kinase is to activate proteins that are responsible for proliferation of granulocytes. The state of tyrosine kinase in normal condition is regulated by cytokines, but mutations that force pathological crossover between chromosomes 9 and 22 results in formation of a fusion gene called BCR-ABL1, where ABL1 has very high activity. Because ABL1 encodes tyrosine kinase, the higher the activity of ABL1 gene, the higher will be the activity of tyrosine kinase. So tyrosine kinase becomes constantly active, and this results in massive production of granulocytes. And chromosome 22 that is formed by pathological reciprocal translocation that has BCR-ABL1 gene called Philadelphia chromosome. As a result of the first mutation, the amount of mature granulocytes in the blood markedly increase. This causes increase in total white blood cell count, but such overproduction of mature granulocytes do not cause any significant symptoms, and this stage called chronic stage of chronic myeloid leukemia. Then the second mutation occurs, and this mutation disrupts cellular maturation. And because maturation becomes disrupted, this results in production of less mature granulocytes and even blast cells. This phase called accelerated phase. In accelerated phase, blast cells crowd out normal cells from the bone marrow, thereby the amount of cells in the bone marrow decrease. And this results in decreasing amount of cells in peripheral circulation and also in lymphocyte migration that causes splenomegaly and hepatomegaly. And with time, additional mutation occurs that disrupts maturation. As a result, a lot of immature granulocytes and blast cells produce, and the amount of blast cells progressively increase and become greater than 20%. And because of this stage called blast crisis. Because the amount of blast cells increase, every pathological alteration that occurs during accelerated phase now become more severe. And as we know, the presence of more than 20% of blast cells called acute leukemia. In case of chronic myeloid leukemia, in 2/3 of cases, acute myeloid leukemia develops, and in 1/3 of cases, acute lymphoblastic leukemia develops. Increase in blast cells cause anemic symptoms, thrombocytopenic symptoms, and symptoms that are related to lymphocytes. In addition to this, overproduction of malignant neutrophils also increases the risk of bacterial infection and cause clinical symptoms as night sweats. And the turnover of high amount of blast cells and neutrophils significantly increase the income of uric acid into the blood that increase the risk of gout and kidney stones. So it's a general picture of pathogenesis in chronic myeloid leukemia. But what we can determine? First of all, the first analysis that we see is complete blood count. Here we see the normal blood analysis of a patient in chronic phase, in accelerated phase, and in blast crisis. So what we can say? First of all, because of tyrosine kinase mutation, the amount of white blood cells will progressively increase from phase to phase. This increase in white blood cells caused by increasing amount of granulocytes, primarily in neutrophils, but also basophils and eosinophils simultaneously increase. And such simultaneous increase in basophils and eosinophils called basophilic-eosinophilic association. Important that if in chronic phase, increase in white blood cells caused by production of most mature forms of neutrophils, and we see that most neutrophils in chronic phase are segmented forms and bands, which are most mature forms. In accelerated phase, because mutation disrupts maturation, bone marrow begin to produce less mature forms of neutrophils. So, as we see in accelerated phase, in the blood, the percentage of mature forms begin to decrease and less mature forms increase. and also we see that even blast cells appear in peripheral blood. In blast crisis, because maturation becomes even more disrupted, mostly immature neutrophils are produced. As we see, the percentage of mature forms continue to decrease, and the amount of immature neutrophils continue to increase. Basically, myelocytes become the predominant form, and in addition to this, the amount of blast cells increase. And recall that blast cells crowd out normal cells from the bone marrow. This leads to decrease in production of normal cells. So, as we see in accelerated phase, with increasing amount of blast cells, red blood cells and hemoglobin begin to decrease. And in blast crisis, because the amount of blast cells become even higher, red blood cells and hemoglobin decrease even further. And the same pattern occurs with platelets, lymphocytes, and monocytes. From phase to phase, with increase in blast cells, their quantity progressively decreases. Very important concept is that, as you see in complete blood count, blast cells in accelerated phase are only 5%. And we said that for accelerated phase, blast cells have to be from 10 to 19. And the same for blast crisis, in complete blood count we see certain percent of blast cells. And for blast crisis, we said the amount of blast should be greater than 20. We have to note that the criteria for blast cells are related not to complete blood count, but to bone marrow aspiration. The concept is that by complete blood count, we determine the amount of cells just in peripheral blood. Recall that cells are produced in the bone marrow, and only after they enter into the blood. So because cells are produced in the bone marrow, the amount of cells that we determine in the bone marrow tell us about the current state more precisely than the amount of cells that we determine by complete blood count. So complete blood count is definitely more commonly used, because it's non-invasive and easy to do method. Bone marrow aspiration is much more invasive, but more precise. So once we see something pathological in complete blood count, we refer such patient for bone marrow aspiration, where we're interested in state of bone marrow production capacity and also in amount of blast in the bone marrow. But once we determine blast cells, we're interested either lymphoblasts or myeloblasts. And for this purpose, we use cytochemical methods. Because in blast crisis it makes a huge difference, is chronic myeloid leukemia progress to acute myeloid leukemia or to acute lymphoblastic leukemia, because they have different treatment. The concept is that under the microscopic examination, in fact, it's very difficult to tell whether it's myeloblast or lymphoblast. So to determine the type of blast cell, we use a certain cytochemical markers. One of them is TDT. TDT is a signature feature of lymphoblast. TDT is DNA polymerase, and the key feature is that TDT is present only in the nucleus of the lymphoblast. So once TDT is positive, we can say that it's lymphoblast. Also, we have PAS reaction, which stands for periodic acid sheaf stain. And this reaction basically determines the amount of glycoproteins in the cytoplasm. And the concept is that lymphoblasts have the greatest amount of glycoproteins in the cytoplasm. So positive PAS reaction equals to lymphoblast. Another marker is myeloperoxidase. And even from the name, we can say that this marker is more specific for myeloblast. So by cytochemical reactions, we can tell is chronic myeloid leukemia progressed to acute myeloid leukemia or to acute lymphoblastic leukemia, which makes a huge difference in treatment. Also, we perform biochemical analysis. And for chronic myeloid leukemia, we are especially interested in the level of uric acid and in the level of lactate dehydrogenase. With uric acid is simple. We know that in chronic myeloid leukemia there are a lot of cells, and their turnover results in constant production of high amount of uric acid that can cause gout and kidney stones. So because of this, by uric acid level we can assess what is the risk of gout and kidney stones. And also, during treatment, the level of uric acid can tell us about the severity of tumor lysis syndrome. But more interesting marker is lactate dehydrogenase. The concept is that blast cells are malignant cells, and as malignant cells, they have very fast metabolism due to the Warburg effect, which is anaerobic glycolysis even with the presence of oxygen. And as we know, to metabolize glucose by anaerobic glycolysis, cell requires lactate dehydrogenase enzyme. So if malignant blast cells has high metabolism, the amount of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme inside the cell is high. And with cell turnover, lactate dehydrogenase enzyme also released into the blood. So by assessment of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme, we can suppose what is the quantity of malignant blast cells, and obviously if lactate dehydrogenase enzyme is high, the amount of blast cells most probably is high, or their metabolism is extremely high, and in both cases, it's a marker of a bad prognosis in patients with chronic myeloid leukemia. So the relevance of lactate dehydrogenase enzyme is that it serves as a marker of a bad prognosis in patients with chronic myeloid leukemia. But to say for sure that it's chronic myeloid leukemia, we have to find the particular mutation that caused this disease. For this purpose, we use cytogenetic methods. First of all, it's karyotyping. Basically, by this analysis, we morphologically examine all chromosomes. And in chronic myeloid leukemia, recall that the mutation forced reciprocal translocation that results in formation of BCR-ABL gene on chromosome 22. And such chromosome 22 called Philadelphia chromosome. And on karyotyping, we can see that one of the 9th chromosomes is enlarged, and one of the chromosomes in 22nd pair is shortened. And such shortened chromosome 22 called Philadelphia chromosome. But karyotyping has a drawback. On such picture, we do not see exactly BCR-ABL gene that cause chronic myeloid leukemia. We just see two pathological chromosomes that are formed due to reciprocal translocation. To determine BCR-ABL gene, we use FISH analysis. And here we can see that ABL gene has red color, BCR gene has green color. So in normal condition, chromosome 9 has red color, chromosome 22 has green color. But if reciprocal translocation occurs, now on chromosome 22 we have ABL gene that has red color and BCR gene that has green color. And in between we have yellow color due to the overlay of red and green colors. And once we detect fusion of BCR-ABL gene, we can say that it's chronic myeloid leukemia for sure. Also, another method that we use is PCR, where we determine the amount of a particular BCR-ABL transcripts. In PCR method, we have a base pair ladder, where we determine the base pair length of nucleic acids. Basically, it's the length of a gene in a chromosome. And we know that pathological BCR-ABL gene has three most common sizes. It's 310, 385, and 481. So if we determine 310 BP transcripts, for example, we can say that this patient has pathological BCR-ABL gene. And as additional method to differentiate malignant neutrophils from normal neutrophils, we use LAB score. Recall that the function of neutrophils is to provide defense against the bacteria. And because of this, inside them, they have a lot of bacteria-killing enzymes. And one of these enzymes is alkaline phosphatase. And because the function of neutrophils is to provide defense against the bacteria, the expression of this enzyme in DNA and thereby the production of this enzyme is extremely high. The problem is that mutation that occurs in malignant cells disrupts the genetic expression of this enzyme. Simply speaking, with mutation, neutrophils forget how to produce alkaline phosphatase. Thereby, the amount of alkaline phosphatase becomes very low, and without this enzyme, neutrophils cannot kill bacteria, and this greatly increases the risk of bacterial infection. So, in chronic myeloid leukemia, LAB score will be minimal, simply because malignant neutrophils do not know how to produce alkaline phosphatase. If you like content, please press like and subscribe button. All the best!